Okay, so we're gonna go over all these games that I played. I won't do like in-depth analysis, but we're gonna go over the games that we had in those five examples. All right, so d4 was played, knight f6. This is my game against Maxime. The first one, c4, c5, d5. All right, so to give you guys some background info, this was the game that I played against Maxime Vachier-Lagrave in Cap d'Agde, France in 2008. This was a knockout tournament. You play two rapid games against each other. If the game is drawn 1-1, you play tiebreaker games. Now I believe Maxime and I think we had played two rapid games and the match was tied. I think we had also played two blitz games maybe, and it was still tied. And so we're in like our fifth or sixth game at this point, and Maxime decided to vary and play the Benko Gambit here. And I had some very nasty preparation courtesy of my trainer, currently my trainer as well, Chris Littlejohn. So cb5 a6 f3. So it's a very sharp line. Again, as certain grandmasters said, you never want to push the pawn, but you're trying to build the connect four here in the center. If you can get the connect four, it's very, very strong. So e6 is played, e4, again building the center, supporting the point. I don't want to really trade here, because then let's say I take, black gets this very big center, and my pawn on f3 can't go to e4, so now I've really hurt my knight on g1, because it can't go to f3, and I can't really develop anything at this point in time. So because of that, it's very, very tricky, and you have to be very precise. So I play e4, build the center point. Now the other thing is, this also it can remind you of something else. So if, as you guys probably remember, I did this collab with Daniel Negreanu, and we're talking about like the Danish Gambit, for example. We're talking about like the Danish Gambit, and one of the big things about the Danish is that you really want to try to push this pawn and hamper this knight, because if black has some waste time moving the knight away, for example, white can be much better. So you really want to take advantage of this knight and disturb the development process for black at the start. So let's get back to the game. So what do we have in the game here? You'll notice it's actually quite similar. I go e5 and I disturb the development of black. Black cannot just go bishop e7 and castle. Black has to deal with this problem of the knight on f6. So Maxime goes queen e7, I go queen e2. Again, I couldn't capture because of the pin. So I break the pin with queen to e2, knight to g8, I go knight to c3, trying to hit the pawn on d5, and then fork the king and the rook, maybe hit the queen. A lot of bad stuff is happening for black. So bishop b7 is played here, and now it's amazing, even these days the computer still is starting to get it, still doesn't understand really right away how bad this can become. So here I play knight h3. And now I think, as I recall during this time period when I was reviewing the lines, I think queen d8 and knight e7 was the best move, but this was a blitz game and neither player had a lot of time to do calculations. So c4 is played. Let's see how long it takes the computer to realize that it's stupid for a change and I'm actually right. So knight f4 still says zeros, queen c5, I took the pawn, takes, I go bishop e3, queen b4, a3, queen a5, bishop d2, bishop e6, I go knight d5 here, plays queen d8, queen c4, rook a7, rook c1. By the way, this is all preparation, you guys, all preparation. This was all known. So I'm pretty sure at this point the computer is wrong. I think this is already like plus one for white, at least at the time with the computers I was using. So he takes, I check, and it's winning. So basically Maxime had to take on d5, and as I recall, this was still very unclear, like takes and bishop b5, and I think white was better when I looked in the old days, but again, you know, it's all relative. So yeah, so this happens, takes, knight c7, takes, knight c6, we trade, I take, Maxime goes knight e5, and this is where we started our game, in the match between the Botez sisters and myself. And in this position, the correct move is bishop a5, and just to give you guys an idea of how difficult this is, you see the valuation, it's not much better. Bishop a5 is the only winning move. So when they miss bishop a5 and rook c8, you can't really say anything negative, because it's just one move that's winning. Everything else, white's better, but it's not easy to play. So in that game I did check king e7 and rook c8 here. Why is king f2 winning? King f2 is good because you bring the rook to the center, and in an endgame your king probably is better on f2 than it is on g1, because you can get to the king side quickly or something like that. I mean, versus from g1, like it's some dank like futuristic thing with king f2. But anyway, bishop a5, rook c8 is what I played, f5, bishop b4, trying to win the game. If the king moves, you lose your bishop on f8, d6. Now I smack. Now I snap. Snap. Check. King moves. I take. Knight f6. Now I just castle here on move 29. I castle on move 29 in this game, because I have style. Rook c8, now a4, and not much more really needs to go on. I don't really need to do much more in the way of analysis. White is up two pawns here, two connected pawns, on top of having the bishop pair here, and so the rest of the game, really no need to say much, just keep going. Trade, bishop d4 here, takes, now a5, and just king b5, a6, and that's game over. So that's how it goes, and white wins the game here, and Maxime resigned. Well, he played rook c8, a7, then king f1 again, passed pawn with the rook behind the pawn, bring the king in, and it's just winning here. So I won this game against Maxime. So let's go on to the next game. Next game is this game against Alexei Shirov. Now this was from the very important tournament in this was important tournament course, as we call it, the time, Tata Steel in 2010. I did win this tournament. This was my first major super tournament victory. And so I do remember this game very, very well. So it went e4, or wait, was it? No, maybe this was the year before. Wait, sorry. Maybe this was the year before. So e4, c5, knight f3, knight c6, d4, we trade. Bishop g5, a6, knight, bishop f6. Now, again, you guys, one thing that's important to remember is that you need to be very careful with your opening preparation, because my idea against Alexei Shirov was to play takes, knight a3, b5, knight d5. Now, the correct order for this in the game is a6, knight a3, b5, takes, gf6, knight d5. Unfortunately, I think maybe it was the nerves or just first super tournament, I promptly played bishop takes f6. And this is actually imprecise, because after gf6, knight a3, black can now play f5, which is an improvement versus just going into the mainline theory with b5, knight d5. So I made a mistake here. I made a mistake in the move order, and so at this point I was actually very unhappy with myself during the game, but I was able to sort of put it aside and focus on the game. So I go knight c4, knight d4, knight e3, bishop g6, knight d5, and already you'll see that the evaluation, white's much better, which tells me that after knight c4, my opponent Alexei Shirov immediately went wrong with knight to d4 here. He's supposed to take and then go knight d4. So Alexei actually confused his orders too, because he wasn't ready for this line during the game. And instead of taking here, he goes here. And already after this, maybe bishop e6 in black's okay, but after bishop g6, knight d5, white is much better, because you have an outpost on d5, and you can also kick the knight on d4 with pawn to c3 next move. So bishop h6 is played, c3, knight e6, bishop d3, takes, knight f4. Knight h3, and this is where we start our game. So king h1, of course not pawn takes knight, because then there's the fossil with bishop c2, which checks the king on g1, and you collect the queen on d1. So king h1, takes. Oh, so in the game I took. Now in the game, Botez played queen a4, which oddly enough, queen a4 is a better move. Now keep in mind, this was a classical game, so it's kind of funny. They played queen a4 here, which is, as you see from the engine, the correct move. Although bishop b7, it's pretty close now when you look at the overall evaluation. So anyway, I take, rook b8. I played rook e2 here, apparently not best. I guess rook f3 is better. Bishop d5, great wooden shield here in the middle of the board with the bishop on d5. It just targets everything. Rook here. And again, white's just much better. The king has no real shelter. The white king is very safe here. And I can always go c4, c5. This king is really on the run. So a4, a5, b5, g3, and rook f6. And I mean, not really a whole lot that I'm going to say about this game, but I end up in a position where it's just really, really good, really, really good for white. Go here, and now c5, and I break through. Queen c5, I take, and it's just losing. If pawn takes, or not d5, pawn takes, there are many ways to win, but I assume bishop e4 is safest because of the fossil. The queen on b6, and now everything just collapses around the black king here. So after c5, he did take, bishop e4, rook d6, trade, queen a5, and here Alexei Shirov resigned, and he resigned because if you go king b8, I just go rook d3 here, and if the queen takes, I take back. If you move the queen away, I just go checkmate in one. The queen covers all the squares, and the bishop covers the other light squares, so the king is completely stuck here. So he resigned after queen takes a5, and that's the reason he resigned this game. So let's keep going. Next game is the game against Penthala Hare Krishna from the Grand Chess Tour in Kolkata. Again, not a whole lot to say about this game. It was a Spanish opening. And, okay, I go here. Pretty normal stuff. Knight a5, bishop g4, c5 takes, d8. Again, pretty normal stuff. And now here, in this position, I play queen to h4 here to attack pawn. Now, both test sisters, they did Andrea and Alexander, they did play queen h4, queen f3, and now g5 is the winning move. Very, very tough move to find if you don't really understand the pawn structure. Basically, the point, as I pointed out when we played the games and afterwards, is that if white gets e5 and knight e4, this knight has great jumps to g5, to f6, to d6. It's supported by the pawn. Also, there might be bishop b3. So at this moment, it's very urgent that you try to you try to prevent this, which is why I play g5 here, completely preventing this, breaking this grip on the e5 square that white has right now. And you're not really worried about your kings if knight f5, queens are off the board. So even though you have a nice knight on f5, queens are off the board, the king is very, very safe here. Also, I get an outpost on e5 for my knight. So g5 is a very, very good move. I think it's the best move. Yes, it is. Now e5 is played by Penthala. He was trying to create complications. Basically, I think he realized that positionally, if he moves the pawn, he gives me the square for my knight, and it's really, really bad. So he goes to e5, sort of desperation, trying to open up something, use the knight, use the bishop, try to use these three pieces and create an attack. Unfortunately, it doesn't really do a whole lot. I just take queen h5, queen h4, he takes, I go over, checks, I trade, and now I take. And even though material is even here, white is completely lost because you can never get this knight off of g3. The bishop is permanently targeting the knight and the king on this diagonal. Like after rook f8, I just moved the bishop. Now it's also planted by a pawn, and white's just lost because the king and the knight. The only reason white loses here. He goes here. I go knight f6, bishop g4. We trade. I go rook e8. And this is even nastier of me, basically positionally forcing rooks off. And you see white can never break the pin here. If you go h4, I take and you lose the knight. If you move the king, I take. There's nothing near the bishop. So basically white is just positionally lost here because of this pin. It's just game over. So he goes here, I just go here, and now I go knight f5. I don't even have to, I can even just go c4, but this pin ends the game. It's just permanently stuck on g3 and you just lose. So this was a very, very nice game for me, knight f5 winning. And this, I think, really helped me get into the running where I was for a brief period in contention with Magnus for first prize in the Tata Steel Grand Chess Tour event. So let's move on, next game. This is a game against Igor Novikov, where I had the white piece. This was from 2002. This is from the New York Masters, played at the Marshall Chess Club. Again, as I pointed out, this was the Sicilian Nydorf. I played the English variation with bishop e3 and f3. So queen d2, knight d7, g4, eight castles, knight b3. I don't even remember. This is interesting because, as I recall, around that time there was a very famous game where white played a4 right away between Vishyanan and Garry Kasparov, played in Iceland. But during this game I played this knight b3 and a4, which I think is not great, although the computer does not hate it on second glance. So maybe it's okay. So it's interesting because a4, I don't remember if this was prep or not, but the fact that I played a4 tells me this must have been some kind of, I feel like this was on the fly inspiration. I think it was on the fly inspiration. I don't think that I had prepared this a4. I think I just played it because it looked interesting. So he goes knight c4, we trade, queen d4. Wow, even then, 2002, I still found good moves. Queen d4 is a good move. G5, knight d7, f4. Okay, he goes h6, g6, best move, takes, rook g1. Again, now it looks like I'm just gambling a pawn, but the point is that black has weak pawns now. You don't have a safe pawn in the center, and g6 is under massive attack for my rook on g1. So here I go f5 again, rip the king is very very weak in the center. If I can just rip open the protection, get rid of these pawns that are kind of shielding the king, I have good chances to win. So he takes, I take, goes e5, I go queen h4. again, trying to maybe line up some bishop e2, h5, maybe queen h5, goes knight f6, bishop e2, setting up an idea with this very nasty check, king e8, rook g6, queen g3. I don't know if this was best. It looks a little bit dubious to me. Actually, it looks dubious, but computer really still likes queen g3. So it's even in 2002, I still was able to find good moves. Goes rook b8, a5. Here, bishop b6. Again, really nice move now. Black is really tied up in knots. The pawn supports the bishop, so now there's nothing black can do on the d-file. Also, this queen and this rook, this pawn also holds the rook, so the bishop is permanently tied down here, which means this rook can never get into the game on e8. So he goes h5, queen h4, d5. I go back, goes here to hold the pawn, bishop d4. Wow, I guess it's not the best move, but it's a very nice move to take advantage of the pin on the diagonal here. And black can't even defend, because then you lose the bishop, or even like rook e6, which also wins the queen. So takes, I take, he takes, I take back. Oh, did I blunder this? Wait. Oh, I blundered. I was supposed to actually play knight takes d5 here. Huh. So I did blunder. So he takes, I take, he checks here. Now here, and now after queen e3, he plays king d8, now after knight d5, it all just collapses. But still. So he trades here, knight c4, knight b6, and again, just trading off materials here. Bishop e5, c3, and game ends, because basically everything collapses here. There's just white just up too much material. So this was a pretty good game as well. So let's move on to the next one. So this was a game that I played in Hungary in Eger in 2001 against Ilija Nebojsa. As I pointed out before, you guys, I told you what the opening was. So it was this open Sicilian, of course, knight f6, as I said about half an hour ago. Trades, e5, knight d5, knight e4, f5, knight d6. Now it's a very weird position, because black basically needs to get quick development. He needs to push the pawn, get this bishop out in a hurry. So he goes castles, I go here, he plays queen h4, c4, and now again, you'll see computer, I think, already says black should play c5. You gotta open up this diagonal. Instead, he tries to get very aggressive with knight g4. I go h3, knight e5, and now I play f4, knight g6, bishop to e3. Now bishop e3 and c5 are both good. I think actually bishop e3 is objectively a little bit better, just because you bring another piece into the game. He goes a5, queen d4, queen f6, I go b3, rook e8, bishop d3. Idea behind bishop d3 again is black wants to open up the center, so I play here to target the pawn if he ever pushes. Here I go rook e1, trade. Now he goes knight h8, and you'll see, like, in this position, the reason black, it's even material, you would think black is fine, but he's not, because the bishop is stuck. So the bishop has no scope at all here. So I go rook e3, bishop c5, and how's your bishop getting into the game? Well, it just isn't. You can't push the pawn. The bishop is in the way of the pawn, so no scope. You can go to a6, but still, you're staring at a pawn chain here, so the bishop has nothing to do. So basically, you end up in a situation where, even though material is equal, black is just positionally lost, because you have a dead bishop that can never get into the game on the diagonals. Goes here. I go here. Rook e1, stop e5. Here, a4. Also, another move, stop the counterplay, because I can always play bishop c2. Like, say black just gets a... this in, I go bishop c2, holding the base of the pawn chain with the bishop, and the bishop still is doing nothing. So it goes here, I go here, knight g8, g4, I go rook g3, goes rook g8, I go rook g1, goes here, bishop d4, rook c8, I take, rook e3. Again, probably not precise here in terms of the game, in terms of how I played this, but not really relevant. So I go here, rook e8. Oh yeah, and he plays this, and now I can go into the end game, and black just loses, because the king is running and the bishop is still stuck behind these pawns. So he goes here, I go here, takes, king c5, and black loses for one reason only: bad bishop from the start of the game. The bishop is the reason black loses. He goes, and he just resigns here, because even if he pushes the pawn, I go king b6, bishop c8, king c7, attacking the bishop, and now I just take, and I move my king and make a queen next move. So that's why after king c5 he resigns. And again, as you see, only reason black lost this game because bishop ended up, the bishop was dead for the whole game because the diagonal was blocked. So that's why very oftentimes when players play this opening, you'll see very early on what they'll do is they will, in many cases, they'll try to play c5 and bishop b7 as fast as they can to open up the position. All right, so let's take a look at the last game. There's not much to this game, actually. This is the game between myself and David Anton Guiaro from the Airthings Masters. This was I guess it was already 3 months ago. It feels more recent than that, but it was 3 months ago. So d4, knight f6, c4, e6, g3, d5, knight f3, playing the Catalan defense with the bishop on the long diagonal towards a8. Goes here, a4, a5, queen c1, trying to recapture the pawn I'm behind. I take b6, I play queen b3 again. I don't really want to castle in this position because if I castle, black goes bishop a6, queen has to move, and then the pawn will fall on e2 next move. So you don't want to do that. So I move the queen quietly out of the line of fire on the diagonal. Bishop a6, go knight c4, trying to attack the pawn on b6 with my knight and my queen. Goes knight d7, go knight e5. Now he plays rook c8, now I go knight to d6. And this is where David Anton, as I pointed out during the event, he made a blunder. He did not play rook c7, which is completely fine. And it's very weird because you feel like, oh man, there's sacks on f7 with this diagonal. There's also takes. But the problem is if I do this, there's this amazing resource, knight to b8, and now it's a double attack of both the bishop and the knight at the same time, and black actually is winning here. Steady takes, I take the knight, goes here, I take, he goes here, I go queen e3. And by the way, you guys, this was the game. So this is exactly what Alexandra and Andrea played against me. I played queen e3 in the game, and now in the game, but against David Anton, he played knight takes e5, which is completely insane. Literally makes no sense at all. You kind of have to go like knight c5 castles and like f5, like I tried to do in my game against them, but it's all really bad. Instead, Anton takes, I take the knight, queen c7, go bishop f3, rook b d8, and after rook d1, it's just completely lost. He goes rook d7, trying to use the pin, trying to double stack it and get back the knight if he can, but after castles, rook d8, I have a really nasty move, knight takes f7, which wins the game on the spot, because after queen takes queen, I do not have to take the queen, after which black would take the rook, but I go rook takes rook. And the problem is, if black takes the rook, you lose the queen. If the queen moves, you lose the rook, and so it's just too much material. So he takes, I take with a knight, and again, I have a rook. I have two rooks and a knight for a queen, which is way too much material here. So takes, rook d6, h5, I just take, h4, knight g5, threatening checkmate in one because the king cannot come up here with the knight holding both squares. g6, I just take, check, and now knight f4, and just rook c1. And David Anton resigned here because, again, I'm threatening to set up the ladder checkmate. If you go g5, I go check, king here, checkmate the ladder, and it's game over. And so after rook c1, David Anton simply resigns here, because there's no way to stop the ladder. It's just game over. So pretty clean game, this last one especially, but I just thought I would do a little bit of analysis for you guys on the game, so you have some background on where they were from.